And welcome to, okay, welcome to Striking a Chord, the appeal of the cello. I'm really pleased. It was almost 2 years ago at a concert here at Hope College when I heard Alicia Eppinger perform. And it's been 2 years since I ran into the lobby after her performance and asked her, would you be willing to do a half class on the cello? Because I realized that many of us, we enjoy the music and the performance, but we don't really know that much about cellos. And thank you, Alicia, she said yes. And then the pandemic happened. And so we've been going back and forth for the last 2 years to make this happen. And so today we're now here in person and on Zoom. So let me introduce Alicia. She joined the Grand Rapids Symphony in 1989, and she was made principal cello in 2011. She has a bachelor's of music performance from the Oberlin Conservatory of Music, and she has a master's degree in music from the Eastman School of Music. Alicia plays in a number of concerts, both solo and in groups, throughout West Michigan. She's a member of the Ensemble Montage, a group of musicians dedicated to bringing contemporary music to West Michigan. I'm finding that wearing a mask, your mouth gets dry. And so I'm stumbling a little bit, but she's also a founding member of Castalia, an all-female quartet that focuses on playing music by female composers. Alicia started playing the cello at the age of 9. She chose the cello, she says, because she had one brother who played the viola and one brother who played the violin. So she went to the cello. She is the daughter of HASS members Gordon and our president, Barbara Stedding. And so, you know, there's musicians say, if you want to fall in love with classical music and opera, what you do is you expose yourself to the beautiful sounds of the soulful instrument, the cello. So I hope that you'll enjoy and you'll discover lots of new things about the cello. Welcome, Alicia.
I don't think my ears are big enough for these. Can you hear me okay? Great. All right. Well, welcome. I am, I'm going to have Andre move the camera onto me, and I'm just going to begin by playing just a little bit. That looks pretty good. Thank you. have to move the camera. Well, thank you. You know, I think that if you were to ask a group of people what their favorite instrument is, you're bound to find a number of people that say to you the cello. They will say, I love the soulful, mellow tones of the cello. They might say, I think it sounds more like the human voice than any instrument. And I think most people know what the cello is. It's gained great popularity really through the 20th century. And even more recently, this is really probably with the advent of YouTube, because as we all know, you can find anything on YouTube, from some really early Baroque cello music to covers of pop tunes of today. And it has become extremely popular, which I find when I go to a high school orchestra concert and there's just a sea of cello players. So today, what we're going to be doing is looking at the history of this instrument. We're going to be looking at a little bit of how it's constructed, the role that it has played over the years. We're going to be looking at a few myths that I'm hoping to bust up today. We're going to learn a little bit of Italian and hopefully just enjoy shining the light on this beautiful instrument for a little while this morning. So welcome to everyone on Zoom. And welcome to everyone here in the classroom. So the string instrument is a pretty basic concept. You've probably taken a rubber band, stretched it tight, you pluck it and you realize it makes a pitch. And if you stretch it a little bit tighter, that pitch goes up. That, I think, is the basis of all string instruments today. So the earliest form of a string instrument would have been a taut string, and it would have been connected to some sort of a resonator, probably a hollowed out gourd of some sort, possibly some sort of a fashion of a fingerboard. The earliest instrument that we're pretty sure came from probably around 5000 BC. I'm sorry for the A being down below. It's a Ravanahatta. This would have been an instrument known in Sri Lanka. We can notice it had a very primitive bow. This is not an original Ravanahatta. None are in existence, but it is thought to have come into existence around 5000 BC. Another early instrument is the rebab. Now, the rebab is found in areas of Sudan and Egypt, and it is still played today. It's a very primitive instrument. As we can see, it is a hollowed out gourd. It has a fashion of a fingerboard. It's kind of just a dowel, but the pitch then can change. There were other early stringed instruments that were not bowed as well. For instance, the lute. The lute is a guitar-like instrument. So here we have a plucked instrument, and we will visit with the lute in a little while as we go through our story here. Another early instrument was the lyre. David from the Bible played the lyre. It's the early predecessor of the modern harp. And the lyre happens to be the instrument that there is one still in existence from about 2500 BC. In 1929, some royal tombs were excavated near Baghdad in Iraq in the ancient city of Ur, which is also a biblical city. And this was a royal tomb, and three different lyres were found. The most special of these had inlaid jewels and inlaid stones. It had a golden bull's head put on the front, so obviously something that was really cherished. That particular lyre was refurbished. And the wood had to be completely redone, but the inlaid work is all original. This golden bull's head that you see here is not original, but the original is just simply in the vault of the museum. This is in a museum in Baghdad. This is the oldest existing string instrument that we have. So these early instruments, the rebab, lyres, lutes, would have traveled basically from the Middle East. And as they find their way in particular into Europe, probably with the nomadic tribes, Arab tribes moving, gypsies, just things would have moved, right? And all of these instruments, of course, were handmade. So perhaps one family visits another family and somebody has some kind of primitive instrument that they built. somebody wants to make something like that. And then there's another version of maybe the rebab that, and this is the way that the instruments developed. They would have changed quite a bit over the years. But they, as they made their way into Europe, this is where the story of the cello will begin. And my first myth, and that is that the cello is a descendant of the viola da gamba. This is something that most people do think is true. If you don't know what a viola da gamba is, have no fear, because I'm going to explain that. So by about 1500, there were basically two families of bowed string instruments in Europe. So we'll look at our first family, which comes from, the names come from the medieval Latin word vitula, which means stringed instrument. So if we think about the time period of around 1200, this is post-Crusade. And we're going to now put ourselves over in Morocco and in Spain. So in Spain, the monarchy and the religious establishment wanted nothing to do with anything Muslim. But the lute was a Muslim instrument. It was figured highly in their cultural life. So the Spanish, in making their own version of this lute-like instrument, called it something else, and they called it the vihuela. So the instrument on the right is a plucked instrument. De mano means hand. Mano is hand. So this is the vihuela de mano. But the vihuela de arco, here's our first Italian word. Excuse me a sec. Arco in Italian or Latin means bow. So arco, a vihuela de arco. So this is an early bowed instrument. These are lute-like instruments. In France, around the same time, a little bit later, we have an instrument called the viol, also coming from the same Latin root. And as we see the instrument on the right, as well as this instrument, this entire family began to be held in this unique way, which was on the lap, maybe between the legs if it was bigger, between your calves. And if we notice also the way the bow is held, we're going to call that like a kind of an underhand grip. So in Italian, gamba means leg. So we have this family began to be called the violas da gamba, meaning they're held on the leg or on the lap. So no matter the size, we can see on the left are really pretty small viola da gamba, and on the right, much bigger, they're still held the same way. The bow grip is what we call underhand. This is not the way I will play my cello, or you will see it in videos of other people playing the cello. I will show you a video of someone playing the viola da gamba as well, so you can see that. A couple other things we might notice about these instruments that might look a little different to you than my cello is that I'll call them the shoulders of the cello. They're very sloped, right? So it's a little of a different size. It's hard to tell in these pictures, but there's 6, 7 strings, something like that, quite a few more. And very importantly is the way that this instrument is tuned. It's primarily tuned in fourths. And this is the way a guitar is tuned and a lute. So the lute and guitar are all in the same family. In music, when we talk about an interval of a fourth, what I mean is we take a particular note, let's say C, count it as one, and we go up. So if I go C, D, E, F, C to F is what we call a fourth. And so the lute would be primarily in fourths, and in one of the sets of two strings next to each other, there would have been a third. That's the way a guitar is tuned if you do play guitar. The other family that we're going to visit, the ancient form of this instrument was the rebec. We probably can tell by the name that this probably came from the rebab, the instrument that came from the Middle East. So we can see here that the instrument probably had more like 3 strings. The bow grip is an overhand bow grip. This instrument featured quite heavily in Renaissance art, and I find it really interesting that it's quite often very angelic creatures that play string instruments in art. and sort of like the next generation of the rebec would have been the lyra de braccio. We remember that instrument, the lyre. I'm sure that's where this instrument got its name, the lyra de braccio. Now we learn another Italian term, the opposite of gamba. We remember gamba is leg, braccio is arm. This entire family was the first stringed instruments that were held consistently and exclusively up here on the under your chin, held by the arm. Therefore, they were called lyra de braccio. We can see that there are, I know you can see there's a lot of strings in this picture. I think there's five main strings. And then there were two low, like drone notes. It's an instrument that didn't quite make it through time, but it's definitely an ancestor. And again, we see our cherubic and angelic creatures playing these instruments, but we can see So here's our lyra de braccio. I'll just go back really briefly to talk about how we have about five strings. And in this family, the lyra de braccio family, we now have a different type of a tuning. They're not in fourths. We now are tuned in fifths. So that means instead of C going up to an F, we have C going to a G. On the bottom of this slide, we can see three instruments that are viola da gambas. The one laying across the top is as well. I believe it's a bigger one. And we can see those sloped shoulders. If you can see, they all have frets, which is like a guitar, has frets. All the viola da gambas have frets. We have many different sizes, but the instrument in the middle is the lyra de braccio. And that's our modern shape that we know of today. So here we have the viola da gamba on the left and the modern cello on the right. You've probably come to the conclusion that the cello comes from the lyra da braccio family. So we'll look at the differences here. We have many strings on the viola da gamba. There's either six or seven. It's hard to tell on this slide. There's a wider fingerboard because there are more strings. We can clearly see the frets and we can clearly see that different shape, the sloped shoulders. On the cello, we have the wider body. As well, if you can tell, the belly of the instrument is bigger. The top and the back of a gamba are flat. And with the cello, it became standard to round that out a bit. We're basically producing more room on the inside of the instrument. Now, by about 1500, maybe 1600, the family that we're going to talk about more now began to be called the viola de braccio family, probably just to differentiate it from viola da gamba. So rather than lyra de braccio, we are now the viola de braccio family. And comes to my second myth, that the cello is a big violin. So if that's a myth, maybe the violin is just a small cello? Nope, that's not the case either. So you might ask yourself, well, which one came first? Neither. Now, in all of our families of instruments, like a rebec here, we have different sizes. They correspond generally to the human voice. So we'll have a soprano rebec, alto, tenor, bass rebec. We'll have the same thing with gambas. There can be a wide variety of gambas. This family went through a lot of changes, but they would even have a contrabass viola da gamba or a piccolo viola da gamba. And in our family, the viola da braccio family, we also had many different sizes. Now we've sort of come down to just having a few, but of course, all of these families went through a lot of changes. So we are now in 1600s, and these instruments are primarily being built in Italy. So we now explore the Italian language a little bit more, and we're going to find out how the cello got its basically meaningless name. First of all, the viola da braccio family dropped the da braccio part, and we're just called the viola family versus the viols of the gamba family. So when we are talking about the Italian language, they have fascinating things that they can do to a noun to change it. So what I mean by that is we take a noun and we can put an ending on it that can be a diminutive ending. It can be an augmentative ending, meaning I make this noun smaller or I make it bigger. So for instance, if I take la casa, which is the house, and I want to say it's a small house, I say that is la casina. Or a tree, l'albero. To a small tree is l'alberello. Okay? Or a big cat, il gatto, is il gattone. So that's an augmentative ending. La porta, the door, I would say, no, go to the big door. That is il portone. So if we're going to take our noun, it's a viola, right? So we're going to put a diminutive ending on that. We'll put ino on that. We have violino. That's the violin. It's a small viola. So we can do the same thing by making that viola big. Violone. Now a violone is probably this larger instrument in this picture. The violone was played. There's a fair bit of music that was written, but it kind of went into obscurity. It's like a really big cello. It's hard to get around. So it would have been used as a bass instrument, but as soon as it tries to do anything more melodic or even slightly virtuosic, I think it was probably pretty cumbersome to play. So if it's too big, what should we do? We add a diminutive ending to the violone, and we have the violone cello. So what I play is a little big viola. So really, if I say I play a cello, you know, in Italian, I guess I'm just saying I play a little, a small or something. It's just people would think I was crazy, right? So the most commonly misspelled letter in this word is the second O. Quite often people will say violin cello, and now you know that that would be a small little viola. Makes no sense, right? So it's a violon cello, and now you know. So we now come to my third myth, which is that the cello is a big, heavy instrument. Yes, it's big, right? And I can't tell you how many times I walk through a doorway and somebody stops me and says, oh, don't you wish you played the piccolo? You know, well, first of all, no. And maybe my parents wouldn't have been happy with that either when I was 10 years old trying to play a piccolo, but a cello is actually more, it's about 5 to 7 pounds. And this is really because of the way it is constructed. So that's what I thought we could look at a little bit today. Here we have a picture of a cello that has been taken apart. On the left, we see basically the box of it, the back, we see the sides of it. All of that wood that you see that is not the black wood is all made of, that's all maple. So the sides are thin pieces of wood that have been steamed and then put on a form, clamped to that form until they maintain that shape. If you can see that the inside of the cello is roughly a figure eight, at all of the corners of the cello, there are actually blocks to help support that shape. There are also many little slats that run around the outside of, well, I guess it's the inside, but at the outer edges that also help just support the shape of the instrument. I will show you now on the right. This is the top of the instrument. This is made of different wood. This is made of spruce. You can probably gather that this is an old instrument. All these little squares of lighter or rectangles of lighter wood, we can kind of ignore. Those are all repair jobs. Those are what we call cleats. They're holding together cracks in the instrument. But what I did want to point out primarily is that long strip of wood, of the lighter wood that runs basically the entire length of the top of the instrument. And that is called the bass bar. If we put the cello back together, we will see that that runs along the bass side of the stringed instrument and therefore closer to the lower string, which in my case is my C string. So if we do put, here's a little diagram of all the different parts of a cello. And what I did want to point out most is on the, is on the right middle, we have a picture of the bridge. If we can see that, under one of the feet of the bridge, and that would be on the bass side of my instrument, that's the bass bar. It's along the top. It's only connected to the top of the instrument. But on the other side, connected to the other foot of the bridge, is what is called the sound post. So the bass bar's role really is to take the vibrations along the top of the instrument and just bring them throughout the entire length of the instrument. The sound post has two jobs. It had number one probably is to keep the instrument from collapsing. It is not held in place by any glue or anything like that. It's just held between the top and the bottom because of the tension on the cello. And it helps protect the cello because we have approximately 80 pounds of pressure on the top of the instrument from the tension of the strings. The other thing that the sound post does is it takes the vibrations from the bridge and from the top of the instrument, transfers it to the back, and we get this huge resonating box. Now, another Italian word we're going to learn today. It's a very beautiful word, and this is what, in Italy, the sound post is called. It has nothing to do with a sound, and it has nothing to do with a post. It's called l'anima, and it means soul. It's interesting that a little dowel of wood would be called the soul of an instrument to a maker. But if I go to an instrument repair shop and say, my instrument doesn't sound right, it sounds kind of tight, or it kind of sounds, maybe it sounds a little flabby. And what they tend to do primarily is take a specialized tool. They go through the F holes of the instrument, grab hold of that little dowel and move it a fraction of even a millimeter. And the cello will sound quite different. This is what we call getting an adjustment. It's a lot like going to a chiropractor. It's just a quick little move and things are better. So that's one of the main things that a cello repairer will do for an instrumentalist that doesn't want their instrument taken apart, like we saw in the first slide. That is akin to like open heart surgery. It's not something you do too often to an instrument. Somebody that repairs instruments is often also a builder. And the builder of any of the stringed instruments is called a luthier. Luthiers will, it's a fascinating job. They find wood from all over the world. They have to especially find that perfect spruce wood for the top of the instrument. The instrument, as I said, is pretty light. It's because it is planed to quite a thin thickness. So these types of planes are used and they get to a certain thickness. They measure not in millimeters, but in tenths of millimeters. And they might use a caliper, something like this, to measure how thick that is. Another thing they might do is simply tap on the wood and listen for a particular resonance. And they know what to listen for, I guess. I think it's fascinating. This is Steve. And Steve is holding up the top of that instrument that you saw on that other slide. That instrument is my instrument. That's the instrument I'm playing here today. It was built in about 1850. Steve did the work for me, and you can tell he's pretty happy with what he did. I think for you all, that could be a really fascinating class here at HASP. I know very little about the building of instruments, but it's really unique. I'm going to come to my last myth, and that is that the bow is an accessory for the string instruments. So early on when bows were first made, they might have looked something like this. That's pretty basic, the bow on the bottom, and it looks an awful lot like the bow on the top, which is from a bow and arrow set. And these bows probably at that time were pretty disposable. If they broke, big deal, throw it away, make a new one, right? These are bows at the shape that these bows went through from the 1500s to the 1700s. So at the top, we see that we definitely have this convex shape to the wood. And as the years went by, it became straighter and straighter until we get to the very bottom bow there. And finally, we have this more concave shape. The wood of the bow is made of rainforest wood, primarily found in Brazil, and it's a wood called Pernambuco. And it is chosen because it is extremely strong, but at the same time, it's very flexible. I can bend this, and it's got sort of a springiness to it. And it's hand-carved. There are so many parts to the bow. I'm not even going to go through this. I just wanted to show you that every little part of this bow has a name. It's a really intricate piece of equipment. And when somebody first goes to buy their cello, like a good cello, I mean, the cello gets bought first. The bow will get bought second. So it's really not so much an accessory. I would really call it the companion. You can have your instrument sound really different with different types of bows. And I would say most professionals have 2 to 3 bows that they think are pretty good, but they'll be used for different uses sometimes. Like somebody might feel like one bow sounds really good when they play Baroque music, and somebody else and their other bow might be much better to produce a really strong sound with more articulation or something like that. So I will come now to the role of the cello over the years. So the cello has gone through many changes itself, but early on, the viola da gamba and the viola da braccio family had different roles as well. So we had the viola da braccio family was primarily used outdoors. Now, this is because if we remember the way it was constructed, it's bigger on the inside. It's more of a resonator. It was louder. Some people even considered it kind of shrill. There were even some police ordinances in effect to make sure that that instrument stayed outside unless it was in a tavern or a cabaret. The viola da gamba, on the other hand, would have been an instrument of aristocracy, people of wealth. This instrument was performed indoors, and the term chamber music really came about from people wanting to have little groups of these instruments. These were called consorts of viols, and it would be like a family, like a soprano viola da gamba through a bass viola da gamba playing music together. And this is where we come get the term of chamber music. Now, there was quite a bit of controversy between the two instruments. And in the 16 and 1700s, both were pretty popular. In fact, in 1740, a doctor of law wrote his treatise. He called it Defense of the Bass Viol Against the Pretensions of the Violoncello. He said, "We give the name viols to those instruments with which gentlemen, merchants, and other people of virtue spend their time. We call the others violins, and they are used in community dancing, weddings, and mummery." I had to look up mummery. I didn't know what that was. It's a form of acting, kind of like pantomime. So I assume they needed a little bit of music to help in the entertainment. So I would call that more of an entertainment instrument, is our family. Eventually, the viola da gamba kind of went into obscurity. It made a comeback kind of in the mid-1900s when there was a lot of interest in the way things used to be done and people wanted to play early music on an early instrument. Now, in 1689, we have our first solo music for a cello, for a violoncello. Domenico Gabrielli was a cello player himself, and he wrote a set of ricercars, which are kind of like preludes, if you've heard of Bach preludes or anything like that. They're just a sort of a simple form. It might have a little bit of a fugue in it, but it basically is just sort of introduces sort of a key that you're in. which means like the harmony that we're going to listen to. So I'm going to sit down. I've been talking quite a lot, and I'm going to play for you a little bit of the second Risser Carr, written by Gabrielli. So again, this is probably the first music that we know of that was written for this instrument as a solo. So we can hear in that music that it's almost like a bass line itself, kind of a glorified bass line, I would call it. And the cello primarily was used as a bass instrument. I just have to pull this video. Okay, sorry about this. All right, so I think you probably have heard this. I'll stare. This is a Bach air from an orchestral suite. Notice that the bass and the cello are playing the same thing. They're in octaves. They're called the bass group. They're playing with a keyboardist and a lutist, and that group all together is called the continuo group. And we notice that the violins get to play the melody all the time. The bass and cello play the same notes as the left hand of the keyboard. And that would have been sort of the most normal use of the cello. All right, now I might need some help to go back to my hi. Yeah, I just need to get back to my my slides. Okay. Oh, okay. Okay. All right, and then we'll go to the next. Okay. Thanks. I'll do my best. So that was written by Bach. Now, also in that same time period between 1717 and 1723, he also wrote one of the most amazing things that we cellists have been left with, and that is the cello suites. He wrote six of these suites for this instrument. And we now see, we're going to hear how it's definitely gone up a level from the Gabrielli. And these suites, there are six of them. They each have six movements. And there's always a prelude. And then we have five what are called the dance movements. And these would have been based on a dance that people might have known. It's kind of like if I said to you, I'm going to play a tango. You have an idea of what a tango sounds like, right? Well, so I'm going to play for you a bourrée. You may not know what a bourrée is, but somebody in 1723 probably did. So I'm going to play for you a bourrée. This is from the third suite. So I did promise you that we would hear a gamba, and I think that we should hear a viola da gamba, because from here on out, we'll only be listening to cellos. This is a piece of music from 17, okay. I told you, you can hear anything on YouTube. So this is a piece by Telemann from 1735. See all those strings and the sloped shoulders, the way it's held, the bow. So the gamba So the gamba was thought to be more of a soloistic type of an instrument. And like I said, it did kind of go into obscurity, and the cello became a more virtuosic instrument. And that is very much due in part to this man, Luigi Baccherini. And Luigi Baccherini was a wonderful cellist himself. This is one of the few pictures that exists of him with a cello, and we can see the way he held the cello. You might have noticed that there is no end pin in this picture. And the end pin wasn't invented until about 1890. So the cello up until that period of time would have been held this way. But we can see that he's holding the bow in that overhand grip. Something that he did is he brought the cello to play in higher ranges and use the fingerboard much more. So he went up quite a bit higher. In his music, we find some of the first use of what we call thumb position. We call it this because when we begin in the lower positions, we use these four fingers. You've noticed that from me probably so far. But as we get higher, the thumb comes into play, and we actually use the thumb as a finger. So I'm going to play for you a little bit of a Baccherini concerto. He wrote a lot of concertos. He wrote a lot of sonatas and a lot of chamber music. And I'm going to hope that there's no ad, but of course there is. So I'm just going to skip to where the cellist actually comes in. And you can notice this man is playing in the Baroque style with his cello. No end pin. Thank you. Here, you'll see him using his thumb. Yeah, so it's like entirely different type of playing, right? Extremely virtuosic. That from then on, really, the cello was used very much in concertos. And we have, in the Romantic period in particular, we have many more cello concertos written, especially by like Robert Schumann and Edward Elgar. Did you have a quick question? And then I'm going to have a lot of time for them at the end, too.
Well,
yeah.
I didn't see a foot on that cello. I didn't see people holding the cello.
Ah, right. So I'm being asked the question that how is that cello being held up? And as I said, the end pin wasn't invented until 1890. So it's the way he's sitting with his legs. He's actually cradling that instrument. And in, when you hold the instrument in that way, you do have to kind of squeeze your legs together a bit more. The end pin just kind of made that a lot easier, but it really, right. And gamba, as you know, now means leg. So, and you know, I maybe didn't mention that I know it might seem a little odd that this came from the viola da braccio family, which means arm, but it's just because it's so big, they just eventually had to find its way to this position that is the way a viola da gamba is held, but it's still not related. We know that now, right? So I'm now going to talk just a little bit about the role of the cello in the orchestra, which is something I know quite a bit about since that's basically what I've been doing for the past 30 something years. So some of our early orchestral music would have been something like Mozart. And we're going to listen to a little bit of a Mozart symphony. This is one of the last symphonies that he did write. And you may know this, but what I wanted to point out is that we will hear the violins playing this exciting melody, right? And we'll listen to what the cello does. I don't know if you can hear it. So that would have been, oh, excuse me. I won't play now for a little bit. That might have been the way the cello's role primarily was early on. But probably the next composer that really gave us sort of a new role was Beethoven. Now, most of you know Beethoven's Fifth Symphony, right? Dramatic and all that. You may not know the second movement, though. And for cellists, this is a wonderful movement because we get to play the melody along with the violas, it's true, but it's one of the first times where we really get a much more soulful, beautiful melody. Almost there, sorry. That's the end of the first movement. So now we come to the second movement, and we will listen to the cellos. So this is the theme of a theme and variations movement. The next composer that really, I think, really understood the soul of the cello is Brahms. And this is one of the pieces that, if it gets programmed, cellos are so happy. This is from Brahms' Second Symphony. And as I said, if that gets programmed, cellists start practicing. And we, anyway, we love being able to shine like that a little bit. Now, the cello and other string instruments aren't just about that soulful, beautiful singing quality. We get to do some other fun things. Tchaikovsky made use of an Italian word, pizzicato. Maybe many of you know what that is. That's the plucking of strings. And in his third movement of the fourth symphony, whoop, I have to find it here. So I have it. Here we go, I think. Okay. So the strings in the first and last section of this movement play entirely pizzicato. So you will notice everyone has even put their bow down to be able to play this better. Oh, you aren't. Okay. Just this one? Okay. I can stop that. I'm done with that one anyway, but. Well, should we just, I think I only have two more that are sound, so. And I can show most of that. Okay. Let's see, I'm a couple more. I think it's that one. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, I hope people on Zoom are able to hear that. You got a heavy dose of pizzicato there. So another really fun thing that string instruments can do is we can play what are called harmonics. And a harmonic is a really pretty cool thing that occurs on string instruments when we press very lightly on the string and not press down. And they can occur all over the cello. I'm not pressing down. So I'll just glide. That kind of idea. If I have time or you want to ask a question about that, I'll spend time, but I could probably talk for an hour about that because it's fascinating. This is just a little bit. I hope I can get the right time.
Looking for a lifeline in these tough times? Well, forget about stocks, real estate, cryptocurrency, or other type.
Okay. I don't know. Right after this, we have some harmonics in the Shostakovich Sonata for cello. So it's not something that's used a whole lot, but it's a pretty cool thing that we can do. Now, aside from that type of a harmonic, we can do what is called a false harmonic. So instead of playing that kind of harmonic, I can change the length of the string. I'm going to put my thumb down a little. I'm going to put it here, and I'm going to, again, press lightly. I can play any note as a harmonic then. It's a very eerie, special kind of quality. Shostakovich, who wrote the last piece we just heard, also wrote this amazing piano trio. And the entire opening, the cellist uses harmonics. I'm going to let this one play a little bit longer. I'm going to hope there's no ad. No, there's not. And I just love this piece of music so much. So we can hear the incredible range too of the cello with that. At the very end where we stopped, the cello is probably about 3 octaves higher than the violin is playing. So that's another thing that that the harmonics can really do for us is it expands our range hugely. Now I'm going to play for you a piece of music that is a newer piece. In the 1900s, the cello as a solo instrument really came into its own. A lot of music was written for this instrument all by itself, somewhat like the Bach suites. And it's really due to the range of the cello that we have really quite a lot written for this instrument. This piece is by George Crumb. He wrote this solo sonata in 1958. So honestly, it's a relatively old piece of music at this point. And what I love about this instrument, this piece, is that to me, it makes great sense. We make the use of pizzicato. And in the first and last section, you will hear a lot of pizzicato. Now, something a contemporary composer might do is take something that you're very familiar with. Let's say I play this chord, right? And instead of basing it on harmony like that we all love, might do something like this. It's a whole different palette, right? And that's what George Crumb does. He kind of stays within a particular palette. The first section is a conversation between Pizzicato and Arco playing. And the little motive that you will hear in the Arco is something that will hold it together for the listener. And the motive that you hear is, okay. Eventually the Arco wins over and plays the whole middle section, which becomes very turbulent. And it has a different but very related motive, and that is. So you'll hear that used throughout the middle section. In the end, the pizzicato will come back, it'll have its conversation with the Arco again. And in the end, it's the pizzicato that will win. So this is just the first movement. It's entitled Fantasia. And for my last Italian word to talk to you today about is the word rubato. It's probably my favorite Italian term because it means freedom. And I would say mostly in more contemporary music, composers have used this term asking the player to play with rubato quite a lot, just so that we can do what we want with their music more. And I think it's a beautiful thing. So there's quite a bit of rubato, but I hope you will enjoy this first movement of George Crumb's Sonata for Solo Violon Cello. Thank you. Here we go. I wanted to show you that we have definitely come into the modern world with cellos. As I said, you can find.
What if I were an eternal? Did you know that Geico has even more ways to save you money?
Talking lizard?
We're almost there.
See Marvel Studios,
this is
Eternals,
a cello quartet from Prague. There are other cello groups that are only cellists that do play. You may have heard this piece. This is a tune by Queen called Bohemian Rhapsody. So, and then I thought I just had to show you this. This is probably this next video that I'm going to show you is possibly some of the reason that the cello is so popular. This group called Piano Guys, who's a cellist and a pianist, in this case, just a cellist. This is him and himself. Yeah. I think if you want to see more of that, you just Google Star Wars cello and you're gonna find it. So anyway, I'm not going too crazy. There are groups like a group called Apocalyptica. There are four cellos. They play like more heavy metal music, but we can hear so many covers of popular music these days. So it's pretty fun. So I just thought we would, I would finish today by talking to you just a little bit about my own life. I'll use me as an example and tell you kind of how I got to where I am today, a little bit about how I got the job I got or other orchestral musicians. So as Andre said, I did start at the age of 9. Before that, I did play piano. I also sang in a choir that my mom led, which is great. That was a wonderful beginning for me, actually. It gave me a big edge to be able to both sing and play piano as I got further on in my education. I spent some summers, in particular in junior high. I went to Blue Lake, I went to Interlock, and these are summer camps, right? It's a pretty typical thing that kids that are into their music are going to start doing. And after my 9th grade session at Interlochen, I was asked if I wanted to audition. I think all the cellists probably in the summer were asked if they wanted to audition for the year-round the boarding school, which is called the Interlochen Arts Academy. So I happened to send in, I think it was a cassette tape, and I did happen to get in. So I spent 3 years there, and I think that gave me a really good start because it was an intensive kind of schooling for me, not unlike a conservatory. So I then went to the Oberlin Conservatory. It is a conservatory. And, you know, most musicians do need to go to a specialized school like this. Just to be really honest with you, they're not cheap. And there are scholarships, but it's such a competitive world. It's just something that you have to kind of live with if that's what you want to do. Another thing that I would say was a bit of a sacrifice, although I enjoyed it, is that I went to summer intensive programs. This is beyond a camp. It's more like an 8-week session of really intensive playing, orchestra, chamber music, master classes, all music all the time. So I went to some places like that rather than coming home and like working at Burger King, which probably would have been great. Maybe I'd have more money, but it doesn't really matter. I am doing what I love. So after Oberlin, I went to the Eastman School of Music, which is in Rochester, New York. And I graduated and I was 24 years old. And at the time I didn't have a job. And my mom, I don't know how she figured this out. She found out that there was an opening in the Grand Rapids Symphony. So she told me about it anyway. I guess I took it from there. And thankfully at Eastman, I had had a class in what we call excerpts. Now excerpts are little bits of orchestral pieces that you play all on your own. Now you heard the Beethoven Fifth Symphony. You remember that? That's an excerpt. And it's something that all cellists need to know to get a job in the symphony. Same with that Brahms excerpt. That's an important thing that you have to know. So I did get the job. I'm really lucky that I was able to do that straight out of school. There's so many of my colleagues that either are not in music or they haven't gotten a full-time job, that kind of thing. So I think I was extremely lucky at that time to get that job. So I think I will just walk you through what an audition is like, and then I'll have some time for questions. So an audition. Let's say I show up. I'm told that I should come on Monday between 10 and 11, and I'm going to be playing sometime between 11 and 12. So I'm going to come, and there's going to be a group of cellists, maybe six, and we're going to play during the course of an hour for a committee out, and the committee is in the hall. In our case, we are in DeVos Hall if we're in the committee. So backstage, you are with maybe the personnel manager, a couple of other people that kind of herd you around, tell you where to warm up, and then when it's time for you to go out, you will take your cello, your instrument, et cetera, and you walk out on stage. Now you walk into the stage and there's always a carpet for you to walk on. And this comes from making sure that nobody in the committee can hear that you're wearing high heels and therefore you must be a woman. Well, probably, but so there's that. The other thing is when you walk out, you don't see anybody because the committee is all seated behind a very large screen. The committee will be maybe 8-9 people, but you do not see them. And as a auditioner, you do not speak because they don't want to hear your voice. And also maybe they know you or something, right? So if you have a question, there is a person on stage with you and you are allowed to kind of whisper a question if you have one, but usually people don't because everything's been decided beforehand. So when we first play at our audition, it tends to be a solo piece, usually the movement of a concerto. Our biggest concertos are by Haydn, Schumann, and Dvorak. And that's what people tend to usually play. You'll play maybe 2 minutes of your concerto. Then you will go into already set list of excerpts. There might only be 3 or 4 that they want to hear because we are only in the first round. Okay. And I also want you to keep in mind that let's say, well, I'm not from anywhere far away, but a person could be coming in from San Francisco and they had to get a hotel room and they're traveling with a cello. A cello needs a seat on the plane. So you're buying 2 tickets. None of this is going to be reimbursed. And let's say we play the first round. Now, all 6 of us have played our round. Maybe I played 2 minutes of a concerto. I played 3 excerpts. I didn't play more than 5 minutes. You know, that's just the way it is. And I walk off stage and we wait till that group plays. Then maybe the personnel manager comes up to that group and says, the committee has decided that it will advance number 4 to the semifinals, for instance. Or there might be nobody advanced. That's what happens. Now, if I'm number 3 and I'm from San Francisco and I spent all that money, I'm done. I played for 5 minutes and I'm done, right? I can go home. I could just hang out in Grand Rapids and maybe have a good time because I have a hotel room. But, you know, that's like what's so hard about this whole process. We come to a second round. It's usually pretty similar. We tend to hear a little bit more from the players because it's a later round and we have already basically weeded out people that are maybe not at the level that they should be. But the screen is still up, that big curtain. The committee still sits behind that. So it's still blind, what we call. For a final round, it is, at least in Grand Rapids, it is up to us if we want to take that curtain down or not and see who's playing. At that point, if the curtain's down, we can receive their resume and we can then call them their name. And they are no longer number four. Up until that point, they've only been a number. However, many orchestras these days in the efforts to be completely fair, keep the curtain up all the time. It's called a 100% blind audition. And many people are hired that way. So therefore, you know, nobody even knows if you graduated from high school, much less went to some conservatory like Juilliard. So I just wanted you to kind of know all that. And with that, I am done with my presentation. I would love to take any questions that you have either on Zoom or here in the classroom. Oh, good. Thank you.
I have actually two questions. Are you now part of the audition process? I assume just the cello. But the second one is, how do you acquire a cello? I'd love to know the mystery of your answer.
Okay, good. So the question for people on Zoom is, if I now am a part of the audition committee now in the selection process. Yes, I am. I've done a lot of that since I've been principal. So I sit on all cello committees and I usually sit on all string committees. So bass, violin, viola, or cello, I'm there as the principal. And I have sat on some other auditions like a tuba audition, trombone, bassoon. And so these are a low instrument. So they're asking me because I play a low instrument and therefore I probably play many of the same parts as them. So yes, I am on, and I much prefer being on that side, even though it's really hard to say no to people. You know, it's a difficult thing no matter what. The other question was how you acquire an instrument that's old. How did I acquire my instrument? So my instrument is from 1850, so it's been around, it's been played all over the place, but instruments simply come up for sale. So somebody plays an instrument for a while, and in the case of my instrument, I believe this person actually had to sell it due to some financial difficulties and sold it, and it was on the market for quite some time. And when I went to look for instruments, you go to an instrument shop, and they usually have many instruments for you to try of many different price ranges, although that's usually what's asked is what is your price range. But there are surprisingly a lot of old instruments that are out there that are on the market that are just kind of flowing through. We take good care of them. They are not disposable. In fact, they're quite the opposite. A string instrument goes up in value with time, so long as it's basically taken care of pretty well. Does that answer your question? Okay, good. Do we have any other questions in the classroom? Okay. Okay, Andre asked how I take care of the cello. So, you know, there's a lot of different things that we need to do. There are some repairs that happen consistently throughout the year. So because the cello and all string instruments are held together with glue, it's a type of a glue that if weather is stressing the wood in any way, the glue seams themselves will open up so that there are no more cracks in the instrument, even though my cello does have a lot of cracks. But so one thing that we do is we have to bring the instrument in periodically and make sure there are no what we call open seams. And usually we can hear a buzzing or there's something wrong with the sound anyway, we can tell and we'll bring it in. But that's something that I have done 2, even 3 times a year. And that tends to happen when the weather is changing. We can be very careful with humidity. That's a big thing, much more so than temperature. So keeping within a consistent humidity range is really important. If you go into any violin shop, they're going to have it set at a certain range, maybe around 40 to 50% all the time. It just has to be, you know, at an optimal range. Another thing that I have to do often is replace the hair of my bow. I don't think I talked about that, but the white stuff on my bow is the hair from the tail of a horse. That has to get replaced maybe 2-3 times a year. I have to put on new strings maybe twice a year, sometimes more. And aside from that, it's really just listening to the instrument. Does it sound okay? Do I need it adjusted? And that's also a normal thing to go in and just have them move maybe the bridge a tiny bit, and in particular, that sound post. There is no oiling of anything, actually. The only thing that gets somewhat lubricated and not with oil is the pegs that tune at the top to make the strings go up and down. Occasionally, those will get kind of stuck, and then it's more of like a soap that's used to help facilitate that. Yeah. Oh, good.
But it didn't send the sugar down my
throat. Uh-huh.
It does when I switch my fast or something.
Yeah.
Is there any way that I, as someone who enjoys music, but doesn't really much about it, is it possible for one to develop more of an appreciation for contemporary music? Because I know people like you and musicians love playing contemporary music.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that is such a good question. The question is, or maybe it's asking a little advice on how to appreciate contemporary music where something like Tchaikovsky is so easy to appreciate. It just goes right to your soul or whatever. It's what you want to hear. You know, in a way, it's time, you know, giving things a chance. It's not unlike a kid that grows up eating macaroni and cheese all the time, right? And just sort of delving into some different tastes a little bit can help. Maybe listening, it's quite possible it might be a little more of an intellectual type of listening. You know what I mean? Like, rather than just letting go and letting the music speak to you, sometimes music takes a more intellectual approach just to try to understand it. I don't know if that would help, but I also don't think it needs to be for everybody. You know, I certainly don't think just because I played that George Crumb piece, I don't think you all should go out and listen to everything he wrote, right? But it's a little bit of exposure. And if it spoke to even one person, that's enough. And that's what we often say. But there is such a wide range of repertoire that it seems a shame not to explore it a little bit. So I don't know if that helps at all. But
I have a question about your first myth. I thought for sure the Viola di Gamba was the early cello.
Right.
And one reason I thought that was I used to do a lot of choral singing, and when they did period instruments, the combo, that if they weren't, so
yeah.
Is that correct? I mean, is that what they do if they don't have enough people to play the gamba, they put the cello into the early music? I'm wondering if that's
right. So the gamba would often take the role of the solo part. There were a lot more like intricate solos written for gambas where the cello, if it was used, would have been used as a bass line instrument. Now some gambas would have been used for bass line instruments as well. And really throughout the 1600s and 1700s, both instruments were around. And so it really would just depend on that composer if they use that. Now we do certain Bach, passions. There's two of the passions, St. John and St. Matthew, where the bass line is taken over by the cello entirely, but there in both of those, there is a viola da gamba solo, often played on the cello just because not that many people play the viola da gamba these days, but they are written for the viola da gamba. Okay, yeah.
One last question.
Sure.
I read that playing the cello helps in memory retention.
Oh. Andre is asking how old we can start playing the cello because it can aid in memory retention. I would say go for it, you know. Now, I think I'm just going to tell you from the experience of teaching adults, the hardest thing for any adult is that they already know what sounds good. And they get very frustrated with themselves. So, but I think it is a well-known fact that music goes into our brain in a way that does facilitate memory. And, you know, you can hear something that, you know, probably a tune from when you were a kid will just strike a chord with you, right? And it just brings you to that place. So, you know, that is a well-known fact. And I encourage anyone to take up the cello.
Thank you.
Oh, you're welcome. It means I covered stuff okay. All right. Good. How did we do?
I do have a couple questions in the chat. Would you like those now?
Yeah, I'm sorry. I didn't realize.
Sorry, I was working with Susan on something. I'm here. The first one is just, has the cello evolved as a solo instrument or did it begin that way? Maybe you answered that throughout the presentation. I'm not sure.
Yeah, I mean, it did really begin more as like the baseline instrument, and as a solo instrument, it kind of took a while. If we think of Boccherini writing, that was really probably in the late 1700s that the cello as more of a solo instrument really started to come into its own.
And then the next one is, do you know the name? I'm going to probably not say this right. Stephen Hauser. Is he good?
Yeah, he's good.
Do you want to go on record of saying whether this person is good or not? I don't know.
Well, he's good and it's unique. He actually goes by his last name. He's Hauser.
Okay. And then please say the names of the wood used for the cello.
Oh, sure. For the cello itself, the body of it, not the top, is all made of maple and the top is spruce. And then for the bow, the type of wood is called pernambuco.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And then last, I think, is what is a typical work week with or without an upcoming concert?
Oh, this question is always so hard because every week is so different for me. So I'm going to start with a classical week, which maybe some of you go to a classical concert with the Grand Rapids Symphony. We perform on Friday and Saturday night. To prepare for that, we rehearse on Tuesday evening. We rehearse twice on Wednesday and we rehearse once on Thursday evening. So we rehearse for 3 days and then we perform for 2 days. That's a typical work week that has a classical concert. Now we do a lot of other type of concerts too. So if let's say I did the opera a few weeks ago. Now that's entirely different. We actually had a rehearsal on a Sunday night. That was not my favorite, from like 7 till 10. And then we rehearsed on Tuesday night and Wednesday night, with Wednesday night being the full dress rehearsal. And then we performed that on Friday night and Sunday afternoon. So just a very weird work week for me. I don't always have all my daytime free like that. There are often concerts that are during the day. So we rehearse possibly during the day. And one thing that does change our schedule is the type of personnel that are used. So in the Grand Rapids Symphony Orchestra, we have about 50 full-time players, but the rest are part-time. And just to make sure those part-time people are able to perhaps have another job and do that, we will often have later in the day rehearsals for the really large groups like that.
Great, thank you. Thanks so much, that's all I have.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks everybody. Thanks for joining us today. It was a pleasure to see you all. Have a wonderful day.